Good evening. As we go to air tonight, three states are facing indefinite stay-at-home orders in a desperate bid to rein in the spread of COVID-19. And while Sydneysiders are doing the right thing and getting tested in droves, the wait time for results has blown out dramatically.
Sydney has heeded the call to get tested, and in a big way.
When we go to testing, it's a lot of traffic.
But the sheer volume of tests, 63,000 today, has meant the wait for results is long and frustrating.
24 hours, understandable, 48 hours, I get it. But when you start getting into the 3, 4, 5 days, it's a bit much.
Kathleen Curry is pregnant and needs a negative result to see her GP.
I've had to reschedule a couple of medical appointments because I thought I'd have my results back by now, but I haven't.
Doctors, day surgeries, even some private hospitals are demanding a negative test before they will let patients in.
Anyone who needs urgent care can get urgent care.
But the long turnaround time means important appointments that have been scheduled for months are being cancelled.
What we need to recognise is this is a challenging circumstance for everyone.
78 new cases today, 21 were infectious in the community, a number that just won't budge.
I am concerned about the emerging risk in Canterbury-Bankstown local government area, so that covers Belmore, Lakemba, Punchbowl and Yagoona. Also areas around Hurstville and Cogra, Marylands, Greystanes, Auburn, Guildford, Mount Druitt and Rudy Hill.
Mystery cases in these suburbs are what they're concerned about.
We're finding unlinked cases in other areas, and that means that there's chains of transmission where you're yet to crack and yet to break.
And it's moving out of Sydney. This is the testing queue in Coffs Harbour, the local stadium now a pop-up clinic. Plus, a couple of COVID-positive removalists have Newcastle on alert.
Absolutely disgusting. New South Wales Health want to be hauled over the coals for this. If they want to protect Newcastle, up the highway, have a stopping zone like they got on the Victorian border.
And in the Southern Highlands, a healthcare worker caught COVID at Campbelltown Hospital.
And because it was a tea room, they had masks off for eating and drinking.
As lockdown grinds away, the Premier gave no insight as to when face-to-face learning will resume, but gave a guarantee builders will be back at work in 11 days.
There'll definitely be construction activity on the 31st of July. I can give you that assurance.
Until then, though, tradies are on a two-week smoko, relying on Centrelink's $600 weekly disaster payment to pay their bills.
The money is actually flowing out the door faster than it would have under JobKeeper.
The Prime Minister's payments are hitting bank accounts within 40 minutes of applying. In just 24 hours, $33 million has gone out the door. Around 500,000 Sydneysiders have either been or are in the process of being paid.
There are two lines of thinking within the state government at the moment. One is to continue down this path and hope to drive cases to as close to zero as possible, which could take more than a month. The second is to just bite the bullet, start slowly opening up in the knowledge there will be cases.
What you've done is flatten the curve. In fact, it's quite flat, but we want it to come down. Now, a lot of that should improve by, I would think, the weekend.
But vaccines are ultimately the only way we can put an end to this pandemic.
Anti-vaxxers obviously live in another universe. The number of people going into our intensive care units are increasing, and the number of people being ventilated are increasing. And sadly, so are the deaths.
Chris O'Keefe, Nine News.
The Premier says there are some green shoots starting to show. Liz Daniels is with me in the studio with the numbers. Liz, a drop in cases today. What does that mean?
Well, Pete, if we concentrate on the last 4 days, you can see the numbers are gradually stepping down in the right direction, but we need to wait to see if that becomes an ongoing trend. Looking at the crucial breakdown, with the purple showing the number of cases which spent some time infectious in the community, that number is still too high. The Premier wants it close to zero before lifting lockdown. Remember, the harsher restrictions were brought in on Saturday, so it will take another couple of days before we see the effect of those measures reflected in the numbers. We are seeing, though, the concentration of active cases shifting as people in the east recover. The yellow is reflecting fewer than 10 cases in most of the original hotspots, but the infections in the west and southwest are mounting, the black showing the worst hit areas. 193 active cases around Bosley Park and in Fairfield, the epicentre, there are 242. Pete, this rapid spread is why Dr. Chant is so worried about the Delta strain.
Liz, thank you. Chris O'Keefe is with me in the studio. Chris, you have some breaking news for us.
Peter, the city of Orange in our central west is likely to go into lockdown from midnight tonight for 7 days. A pet food delivery driver from southwest Sydney has infected a local who works at nearby Blaney, who has then been to 5 shops and venues all around Orange, and there is serious concern that the virus has spread there. Now, there are roughly 50,000 people who live in and around the Orange LGA. There are crisis meetings occurring right now, and a major testing effort will be underway in the next 24 hours. But this is a very serious situation, Peter.
Chris, thank you. More details have come to light about the circumstances surrounding the tragic death of a mother in Sydney's southwest who had been diagnosed with COVID. Saida Shalka refused treatment in special health accommodation when diagnosed with the virus. 3 days later, she was dead.
She came to Australia to flee bombings by ISIS, but Saida Shalka died inside her Green Valley home with a virus that has infected her entire household.
Very quiet family they were. This has hit hard.
The family are refugees. Their hometown, Bat Naya, in northern Iraq, was razed to the ground by ISIS in 2014. They came to Australia for a better life. Their immaculately kept Green Valley home surrounded by the trucks her twin sons used in their work as removalists. One of the twins, Roni, posting this tribute to his mother online, which says, "Mum, my love, you are my life. You left us, my dear mum." Roni, his brother Ramzan and 2 other family members forced to isolate in their cars yesterday as their mother's body was removed from the house. Saida was actively involved in the Chaldean Catholic community, volunteering at St Mary's at Fairfield. She tested positive to COVID 3 days before her death.
That family were offered care and were offered transport to alternate facility.
They made the decision to stay at home.
You can deteriorate quite quickly with COVID. We're not dealing with a mild case of flu where you've got some pre-existing immunity.
There are 1,418 active COVID cases in the state. Most of these are in special health accommodation. However, there are some who choose to isolate at home. 95 are in hospital, 27 are in ICU, 11 on ventilators. Friends and extended family have been posting online tributes for the 54-year-old, unable to physically comfort her husband or children who remain isolated in the family home. Laura Tunstall, Nine News.
Even though most students are currently learning from home, COVID has managed to infiltrate a school in Sydney's west. Nine's Kate Creedon is at Westmead tonight. Kate, Mother Teresa Primary has been shut down.
Yeah, that's right, Pete. The school has been closed after 2 members of the school community tested positive to COVID. Nine News understands this relates to a student and a parent. However, the school has been told by New South Wales Health that they don't believe they were contagious while they were here on school grounds. However, as a precaution, all students and teachers have been told to get tested and isolate until they receive a negative result. Now, the school has undergone a deep clean last night. It will be cleaned once again tomorrow before reopening to teachers and children of essential workers on Friday, Pete.
OK, Kate Creedon at Westmead, thank you. A reduced public transport timetable caught out Sydney's commuters this morning. Many of them essential workers and children who have no choice but to continue using their usual services.
Essential worker Chris Downs still leaves his Dean Park home before dawn. His rubbish removal service simply can't stop. His wife is an aged and disability care worker. She's still needed at work. A lockdown juggling act all the more difficult with 4 school-age kids.
We don't get any extra support at all.
Instead, copying another COVID complication, Sydney bus and train services suddenly slashed. Transport New South Wales did post on social media.
Only for essential workers, those people will have to use our services.
But what about their kids?
Yesterday, about 9:30, my wife got a notification that there was no school buses running anymore.
Just 11 and 13 years old, Chris's children waited here on their own at this remote bus stop for a school bus they weren't told would never come.
At Concord Hospital, the suddenly limited service sending staff and patients scrambling.
Yeah, I sat at the bus stop for an hour. When you get up at 6 o'clock in the morning to catch a train at 7 to get here by 10. And just make it.
Obviously, one of the issues is that there were quite a number of people who come out of southwest Sydney who would normally be driving public transport.
The timetable turnaround set to last 2 weeks. Trains and buses will operate a Sunday schedule, ferries a Saturday, because right now public transport usage is at about 5%, mostly essential workers.
We're not going to cover everybody, and I do apologise that people are taking longer to get to work.
Ruth Wynne-Williams, Nine News.